The Roadster Shop chassis for LokJaw has arrived, and I'm busting it open.
Binks Built, protected by AMSOIL, with support from Roadster Shop and Nitto.
Before we bust this baby open, you guys have been commenting up a storm. So I want to answer a few of your questions. Let's get to that. All right, the first one is from Majobus. I think I said it right. This is no longer just a backyard build. This is balls to the wall stuff here. Do you plan on displaying it at SEMA? Damn straight, Majobus. We've got offers to place it in booths all over the show. We'll be there. Next one is from Craig Bowers, and he writes, I really like the theme and concept of the whole build, and I appreciate the effort and labor. What do you think about adding more muffler volume to make it sleeper quiet, then use electric exhaust cutouts to bypass them when you want it loud? Sleeper, huh? I think the blower through the hood, that'll be a giveaway right there. So as to muffler volume, how about none? Next one is from Marshall Rugg. What do you think of adding a sliding rear window like most older trucks had from the factory? Well, this truck is a big window, and that's kind of rare. You only got it with certain option packages. And besides, we don't need a sliding rear window because we're not running a camper shell. The next one is from Posh Ah Stookie. Is that correct? Referring to Clint at ATS. Jesus, this guy has forgotten more about the Allison 1000 than what I know about it. He's a wealth of knowledge. I also heard he's converted the instrumentation in ATS DynoCell to Banks eyedashes. Thank you for that, Clint. Great partnership, guys. Can't wait to see what comes of it. We all know that a lot of you have strong feelings about ATS. All I can say is we'll report exactly what happens all the way. Peter A.D. I've never clicked on a Banks video and not learned something. What's the next project? Well, we're going to the mountain. Pikes Peak, that is. The record holder is Scott Birdsall with a Cummins. We think we can give him some trouble with the Banks D-Max. What do you think of that? Next one is Richard G. Referring to Roadster Shop, so nice to see work from real master craftsmen. Rare these days. Kudos, guys, kudos. It figures I'd find it on Banks' channel. Excellent engineers working with excellent engineers. You guys rock. Thank you, Richard. I appreciate that. I really appreciate that. The next one is from Chris. What are you planning for the interior? Leave it old and rusty or fix it up? How about TMI seats with bead rolled door panels? Funny you mentioned TMI, Tucinardi Manufacturing Incorporated. We've been speaking to those guys, and they're gonna do our seats, door panels, center console, the whole Megilla. The next one is from Captain Jack. I just wanna say, aye, matey. He writes, Gale Banks, the ultimate engineering geek. Oh man, I've been called that. Can you share, oh, I love this. Can you share what your next patent covers, or is it top secret? Well, I just got a couple of patents. I'm actually working on 3 more patents, and I'm not gonna tell you a damn thing. And the last one is from Jay Russell. You know how you can improve the truck? By putting a, if it's smoking, it's broken sticker on the back window. My pet subject. If there's smoke in the air, that's horsepower you can see but not use. Just plain lame. This truck will not do that. I want the horsepower to rotate the earth. Speaking of this truck, let's bust this thing open. All right, how cool is this? I get an owner's manual with my name on it for the chassis. Page 1 is chassis parts. Oh, there's some sub-assemblies, laser cut tube detail, Looks like some more sub-assemblies, horizontal dimensions, vertical dimensions, an assembled chassis, and oh, this is real important if you're going to slam the thing, lay frame. This is ride height, normal ride height to the ground plane. Well, I think I've got some light reading for tonight. I see you. Hey, Eric, can you give me a hand here? Let's get a hold of this so it doesn't fall in there. I'll say one thing. It's a really nice looking piece of work. There's reluctor wheels here on the rear end, on both sides, and on the front end, there's leads coming out of these hubs, which you can see right here. I think we've got reluctor wheels or trigger wheels in here and the sensor. We could do an anti-slip, like a traction control. Just need the four corners. So that's rear shocks. The bags are kind of tapered. I wonder what the pinion rise looks like. And while we're back here, this Watts link, or as I heard somebody say the other day, for the first time in my entire life, Z-link. Apparently the younger guys don't know the history of what we're looking at right now. So they call it a Z. They don't give credit to Watts. I don't think we're going to have any issues with tearing any of this stuff apart. It is hell for stout, my God. I love the way they've boxed in a lot of the stuff. And what's really cool is as the frame rail traverses up, you've got a situation where, you know, it's full height there. Then we go to this radius on the outside, just a angle change on the inside, but brake lines on here. That's meticulous work already done. But there's a lot going on here with the torque that the engine applies to the frame through the engine mounts and the twist that's put into the frame, and that's usually expressed in foot-pounds per degree of frame twist. I think we've got a pretty stout section here. On some of the old, I think it's probably back in the 60s, maybe the 50s, GM used to do X-frames where they had cross members which X'd across. The engine's trying to twist the chassis one way, the ground is trying to resist the chassis rotation. But it looks like they've done a job here that's going to help us a lot. We don't want to twist the chassis, and we're going to make big torque numbers. And torque is what twists the chassis. This front suspension is also very magic. Okay, here we've got the caliper mount. It's got a key on it. The guys at Kibbe did a beautiful job with this thing. It keys into the upright or knuckle or spindle, whatever you want to call this thing. That's a beautiful, beautiful setup there. It's got kind of a little pinch hole here to pop it off if you want to pop it off later, but it pops off pretty easily. So that key gives it beautiful stability against the braking loads. Very nice looking, really stout sway bar. And if we go out and start cornering this thing, we're going to have to think about the sway bar diameter or the roll stabilizer diameter. You know, we're putting RideTech chocks on here and they are adjustable, so that will help out a lot. And here's your upper mount and there's your lower for the RideTechs. The beauty of this is it's done in CAD. You're not just pasting stuff on. A lot of the programs, you can do stress analysis. You can look at the distribution of stress as load is applied and removed. But it looks like they've done some reinforcement. What I think is really sexy is this trans mount. That thing bolts through. To pull the trans, you pull that, slide it forward, and you can pull the mount, that part of the mounting system, out of the vehicle. Now, I don't know if there's a plate underneath there. Is there? Does that bolt go through a bottom plate? You got to pull the bolt to pull that out, that mount out.
Yep, fairly big size slot that might account for that.
Yeah, that could be. Yeah.
Front mounted.
Yeah, if it mounts in the front, absolutely, it would slide forward enough to clear the cross member. And this is all joined together to take the load from these two small tubes out. Let's have a look at the rear end in a little more detail. Power feeds in through this strange chrome moly yoke, then into this billet aluminum pinion carrier assembly. That's pretty sexy. And then into their case itself. This is a nodular iron casting. Looks brutally strong. Nice perimeter detail milling the exterior of it. And this is a big bore. When you get up to 35 spline axles, you gotta have a bigger bore to house them, their diameter. And this is 35 spline axles. Then we've got this 3-inch quarter wall drawn over mandrel tubing. DOM tubing is not seamless. It has a seam to start with. So you're starting with a bigger diameter. Then it gets pointed and reduced in size, and the weld is incredibly dense and strong when you're done. So you have dimensionally very correct tubing, incredible metal density, especially in the weld, very strong. Then we come out to the hubs, and of course this is a full floater, which means that all the wheel action, all the wheel loads or torque moments are applied to the two bearings inside this assembly, not to the axle. With a conventional axle, where you have the mounting flange for the wheel on the end of the axle, all in one piece, the tire, when it loads, puts a hell of a bending moment on the axle. With a full floater, that's completely gone. Now the secret inside, and that's the Eaton Truetrac. We've got Eaton inside, so to speak, but here's what the little baby looks like. So this one, I believe, is a 5-pinion, yeah? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is a 5-pinion, all gear, no clutches, no friction modifiers need to be added to the gear lube. Let's flip it over to the other side. So this is a positive traction device. You can see the 5 independent gears through these openings. So these are basically referred to as planetaries, but I'm going to tell you, their knowledge of this science is interplanetary. These things are extremely smooth. The way they transition power side to side, you don't even know it's there. If you have one of these in a front drive automobile, this thing doesn't cause torque steer. It's just one beautiful piece of equipment. The one thing I can't understand with these things is how these guys dream them up. I mean, I'm an engine guy, and that's kind of complex. But these guys that figure out this kind of stuff and do it all with gears, pure magic. Thank you, Eaton. Inside, we've got a 389 US gear ring and pinion. Oh, by the way, those 35 spline axles are made out of high tough, and they have a torque capacity of 9,200 pounds. And with those 389 gears, I've got a 3.89 torque multiplication. So if I'm putting in 1,000 pound feet at the companion flange, then I've got 3,890 pounds of torque in that axle. So you can see we've got a lot of overhead. I'd like to put a lot more torque in here, but even if we go to 1,500 or even 2,000, we're still within the limit of the axles. And of course, we're really within the limit of these hubs and everything else. This stuff is way over design. Oh, what do we got here? Little gift box. Well, we've got us a lube locker sticker and gasket. That's pretty sweet. Ooh, this looks like, oh, look at that. There's our metal tag. I assume that's for the chassis, ultimately. And here we've got, this appears to be a service manual. All right, congratulations. All about the hardware, the grease and lubrication, the brakes. Oh, babe, your upper and lower arms. spindle two control arms. This is all specific to this one chassis, the airbags, the shock mounts, the steering rack, sway bar assembly. Oh man, now we get into the geometry. Oh, motion ratio, 0.65, anti-dive, 3 degrees. 60-inch track width. Of course, that's specified with certain brakes. Wow, I gotta say, these guys at Roadster Shop, you just don't see stuff like this in the aftermarket. Stunning, stunning. Everything with you guys is this way, isn't it? This is a piece of automotive jewelry. So Josh and all you guys at Roadster Shop, not only do I like this thing, I love it.
In the next episode, Gale gives us some cam science.
Guys, we're just getting started. I don't want you to miss a moment. So be sure to like and subscribe.